Hello, my name is Joe Thomas. I'm a critical care nurse and currently serve as patient blood management director for Acumen. I'm actually been a member of SABM for the past 13 years, and it's an honor to bring you this presentation as part of the Iron Corner Symposium. Most relevant to this presentation, however, is that for the past 13 years, in various clinical roles, I've been involved both directly and indirectly with the administration and oversight of thousands of infusions of intravenous iron. I've been involved in the education of patients, nurses, physicians, and certainly helped to assess, monitor, and manage adverse events. So today we'll be speaking on the guidance and approach to potential side effects, including hypersensitivity to IV iron, the nursing perspective. Let's talk about iron. You may get the perception from the title that the scope of this presentation will be relatively narrow, but I assure you that we'll actually cover a very comprehensive review of intravenous iron. And so from the learning objectives here, you can see that we'll discuss and explain the evaluation of iron deficiency anemia and labs to guide effective management of patient outcomes. The second objective is to evaluate the five IV iron preparations, dosing, and administration. We'll also describe the risks and benefits of IV iron therapy to patients that are receiving the therapy. Well, let's begin with some fast facts about iron for all of you Jeopardy fans out there. I think most of us understand the role that iron plays in normal hemoglobin synthesis and certainly how critical it is to ensure that as we have hemoglobin that we can carry and deliver oxygen. However, many people may be unaware of the fact that iron is involved and critical for metabolism, for the synthesis of DNA, and involved in hundreds of enzymatic processes. The total body iron content in a normal human being usually ranges between 2 and 4 grams. In fact, as I read just the other day, if you took all the iron in a human body, you could create a 3-inch nail. So there's an illustration for you. About 2/3 of that is in hemoglobin, but the other 1/3 of iron in our body is often in storage in the reticuloendothelial system and also in ferritin. It's interesting to understand the balance that occurs with iron and that in which we absorb versus which we take in every day. So some individuals may consume between 10 and 30 milligrams of iron through their diet. However, we typically only absorb about 1 to 2 milligrams of that iron unless iron deficiency is present. And that's important to ensure that we don't have too much iron or iron overload, because we only lose usually about 1 to 2 milligrams every day through skin, hair, intestinal cells, women with pregnancy or through their menstrual cycle. And then, of course, if you're hospitalized or if you have surgery or bleeding, you'll often lose iron at a much more rapid pace. I think it's also interesting to understand too that for every milligram of iron, or that's what it takes in order to develop 1 milliliter of red blood cells, or again, 1 milligram of iron is in every milliliter of packed red blood cells. While many nurses are unaware of the prevalence or the incidence of iron deficiency anemia, I think this is something that everyone should have a better understanding of, because again, most of our patients that we manage today do have some form of anemia. And the most common form of nutritionally based or nutritional deficiency anemia is that of iron deficiency anemia. In fact, estimates can vary based on the article you're reading, but some show that as many as 17% of adults over the age of 65 may have iron deficiency anemia. And many of the patients that we manage and the chronic conditions that we manage today, those patients are at high risk or have a high prevalence of iron deficiency anemia. Anybody with chronic kidney disease or end-stage renal failure disease, that's a very common condition associated with CKD. Genitourinary disorders, especially if there's some chronic or acute blood loss, gastrointestinal disorders, whether through blood loss or malabsorption, and then certainly a lot of the patients that are hospitalized, critical care patients may, as much as 40% of which may have iron deficiency anemia, and patients that you may see if you have an interest in preoperative anemia management, again, a significant percentage of patients going for major blood loss surgery often have iron deficiency anemia. So I think, and we'll talk about the best way to identify and manage iron deficiency anemia, but I think it's critical for all nurses to understand these parameters. So now that we understand the prevalence or the incidence of iron deficiency anemia, let's focus on the next portion of this talk as to the laboratory evaluation of iron deficiency anemia and monitoring. I think we'll start at a high level with just the CBC. Most clinicians are familiar with the CBC. We're all familiar with hemoglobin, hematocrit. And so when we start with the World Health Organization guideline, although there are a lot of experts that challenge how anemia is defined in the population, but for the sake of using the World Health Organization guidelines, they use a hemoglobin less than 13 for males and a hemoglobin less than 12 for females as defining patients who would be anemic. Again, reference ranges may vary based on your hospital or the articles that you're reading, but let's use those to begin with. While most clinicians are very familiar with the hemoglobin and hematocrit, many aren't as familiar with the red blood cell indices. And we won't go through all of them, but I think it's important to understand at least two of them, the mean corpuscular volume and the red blood cell distribution width, also seen really as the MCV and the RDW when you look at a CBC. So let's start with the MCV, which I would say best is described as the size or the volume of the red blood cells. And as we know, hemoglobin and iron are such a large component of the red blood cell. As iron deficiency occurs and as less of a vital ingredient for hemoglobin or the red blood cell is available, the body can still make as many red blood cells, it just starts to make them smaller. So a lower MCV, and the normal range is usually 80 to 100, once it starts to get into the low 80s or below 80, that is one sign of iron deficiency anemia. It can mean multiple things, but again, it's a very good sign that further investigation is needed. Iron deficiency anemia can be normocytic, though it can be in that range of 80 to 100, so it shouldn't be the only test used to define or identify iron deficiency. And red blood cell distribution width, I think, is also important as it looks at the range of the sizes of the red blood cells. Normally, between 11.5 to 14.5%, and as you see an increase in the RDW, that's also a pretty good sign of iron deficiency anemia, especially if you have a low MCV and a high RDW with anemia, that is definitely an indication that further testing is necessary. The process of investigating iron deficiency has become much more sophisticated and complex today, and that's a good thing. It allows us additional capacity to differentiate between iron deficiency anemia and other types of anemia. However, I'm going to keep the scope relatively narrow on the four most common types of iron studies that we utilize in the United States, typically ferritin, serum iron, total iron binding capacity, and transferrin saturation. We'll start with ferritin, which is often considered the most popular and the most accurate under normal circumstances to evaluate iron stores. It's an intracellular protein that stores iron, releases it in a controlled fashion, and again, it allows us the ability to understand the amount of iron storage available in normal individuals. There is some controversy, though, over how the lower limit or the reference ranges may be, with some reference ranges showing the lower limits at 12 to 20 in females, 30 to 45 in males, but a lot of experts believe that's too low. In fact, many recommendations, including those of the KDOQI guidelines for renal failure, really put the number for absolute iron deficiency below 100 ferritin, and even allow some flexibility between 100 and 200 for functional iron deficiency. So it's important to understand that what you see as you're evaluating the labs may not always tell the clear picture, and it certainly plays a role as you evaluate, and we'll go into the next slide, the fact that ferritin, while one of the most popular and accurate tests, is also known as an acute phase reactant. And you may have heard that phrase before with other labs, but with ferritin, in the face of acute or in some cases chronic inflammation, Remember that iron increases basically into the reticuloendothelial system. It leaves the serum and the blood, goes into storage, and by doing so, it often will falsely elevate ferritin levels in a patient with acute inflammation. So even if you see a patient with a normal to high ferritin, but one that's anemic and based on other labs, it doesn't always rule out iron deficiency. So we'll leave it with this with ferritin, that a low ferritin is the best laboratory indicator of iron depletion. However, it's important to look at other labs, other iron parameters, and certainly the patient himself or herself to understand that if there is a normal or elevated ferritin, but other indications of iron deficiency, that the ferritin, again, certainly at a normal or high level, does not rule out iron deficiency. Let's now discuss serum iron a little bit more briefly. Again, it is one of the four iron parameters or iron studies. However, it's not often used as regularly, but it is, the reference range is between 50 and 150. It would be decreased in iron deficiency, but it can also be decreased when there's acute or chronic inflammation. The reason that serum iron is considered somewhat unreliable is the amount of variation that may exist in an individual throughout the day, or based on things like diet, if they had just taken some oral iron. And so you may see values vary between 10 and 40% in an individual within a single day or from day to day. So it's important to know that with serum iron, it should be one of the four tests used. It will typically be decreased in iron deficiency anemia, but it should be used with all of the other iron studies. Total iron binding capacity is an indirect measure of transferrin concentration, and it can be used interchangeably with transferrin, which is the plasma protein for transport of iron. TIBC is what I'll use today, but that's typically in a reference range of 200 to 400. And so this allows us to see the kind of an inverse relationship with some of the other iron parameters, allows us to see how much transferrin is available to be bound. And so when in the face of iron deficiency, you would actually often see an increase in the TIBC. However, like we're learning about with some of the other iron studies, it may be altered if there's acute or chronic inflammation. So the TIBC, even if there's iron deficiency, may be decreased in inflammatory states, including anemia of inflammation or chronic disease, as we've called it, malnutrition, liver disease, and malignancy. And I'll summarize these nicely at the end with a table which will help to, again, better evaluate iron deficiency anemia, anemia of chronic inflammation or acute inflammation, or both, because it can become somewhat complicated at times. One of my favorite, and I know, again, many clinicians will utilize the transferrin saturation along with ferritin to guide, well, first to identify iron deficiency anemia, but also to guide the management of iron deficiency. And so the transferrin saturation, also known as TSAT, is the percent, and that percent saturation reflects iron available for erythropoiesis. And this is important because even though the patient may have plenty of iron in their body, it doesn't mean that all of it or some of it is available for red blood cell production, erythropoiesis. So this actually gives us a saturation or a percent of iron available directly for red blood cell production. The transferrin saturation is often reported as a percent saturation. It's actually a calculation between the serum iron and the TIBC, and the reference ranges that you'll see might be between 20 and 40% or 20 and 45%. If the patient or the individual has a transferrin saturation at less than 20%, that's very consistent with iron deficiency anemia or functional iron deficiency. And remember that going back to the KDOQI guidelines, that they really set a guideline or a target to maintain the transferrin saturation at greater than 20% in chronic kidney disease, or again, in other circumstances, in order to maintain adequate iron levels for erythropoiesis. Greater than 45% may suggest iron overload, but it's important If you are looking at then the transferrin saturation, if you've recently given IV iron, to recognize that you may see a transient increase in the transferrin saturation after IV iron treatment. So not to be too alarmed if it was, again, a very recent IV iron administration and the transferrin saturation is elevated. We've reviewed some of the more common iron studies, but I think there's also one concept I'd like to briefly review, and that is what's known as functional iron deficiency. Much of the literature that's been published over the years has focused on absolute iron deficiency, but a relatively newer concept for many clinicians is what's known as, again, functional iron deficiency. Chronic or acutely ill patients will commonly have functional iron deficiency where they may show a normal to even elevated ferritin level, but still have dysfunctional erythropoiesis because of having inadequate amounts of iron available or released to actually create and then help to keep up with red blood cell production as needed by the body. More commonly, this is seen in patients who are hospitalized, patients who are post-operative, certainly trauma patients, some with inflammatory bowel disease, rheumatoid arthritis, other patients with a chronic inflammatory process like this, and certainly critically ill patients. So again, a lot of the patients that we care for today, both in and outside of hospitals. We'll have a table on this at the end, as I mentioned, but just to know how it's characterized by, you'll typically see a low serum iron, a low total iron binding capacity, a low transferrin saturation, but either a normal or even elevated ferritin level. And so if there's inflammation, and why this is important for clinicians to understand, yes, the ferritin will be somewhat falsely elevated, and that's important to distinguish between an absolute iron deficiency or functional iron deficiency. The transferrin saturation will be decreased. Oral iron, enteric iron absorption will be significantly impaired, and the release of iron that may be available, might be right there in the patient's body, but the release of that iron from storage will also be significantly impaired. So therefore, the erythroid cells, the red blood cells immaturely, will be deprived of the iron that they need to mature and develop. Some of you may have heard of this term, but what we often think of as functional iron deficiency is a term that we've called anemia of chronic disease or anemia of chronic inflammation. So we'll leave you with this table to help evaluate iron deficiency anemia and anemia of inflammation. So as mentioned, under normal circumstances in a patient with iron deficiency anemia, we'll start with the first column there, and I'll focus on the area in green. But with serum iron decreased in iron deficiency anemia, transferrin, our total iron binding capacity, will be increased. Remember, that's sort of the opposite of the others because this shows how much transferrin is available to take on additional iron. Transferrin saturation will be decreased, and the ferritin will often be decreased. Now, relatively consistent with the iron deficiency anemia parameters is anemia of inflammation, with the exception of typically the TIBC and the ferritin. So the TIBC may actually be normal or decreased with anemia of inflammation, and the ferritin may be normal or even increased. And it's important to distinguish between those two. Where I'll really throw you a wrench is when you might have both, and that's not uncommon as well. And you may just have everything decreased, or the ferritin may be normal in that circumstances if you have iron deficiency anemia or anemia of chronic or acute inflammation. I've included some other laboratory studies that are starting to be utilized more often. We're leaving them outside of the scope of this presentation, but I did want to include them in the slide for your reference. And it is important to know that we are evolving in our process of evaluating iron deficiency with soluble transferrin receptors and the soluble transferrin receptor ferritin index, hepcidin, CRPs, even reticulocyte hemoglobin levels, and the ability to evaluate the hemoglobin and iron really within a reticulocyte. So these are all, again, new emerging ways to continue our process of evaluating iron deficiency anemia. So now that everyone has a better understanding of how to identify iron deficiency anemia, it's of course important to understand how we can manage iron deficiency anemia. So the next section will be the management of iron deficiency, benefits and risks of parenteral iron therapy. We always have to start with oral iron or enteric iron. It still remains a very common therapy today, rightfully so. There are some pros to oral iron. However, there are also a number of downsides or limitations with oral iron that we have to consider and really balance with regards to the patient. Of course, oral iron will have a lower cost. In some ways, it has more of an ease of use going down the road to a CVS to get a box of oral iron. Maybe easier than going in at times for intravenous iron infusions. However, and most clinicians are familiar with this, the tolerance of oral iron, the side effects of oral iron, especially on the gastrointestinal system with cramping and diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, leads to significant non-compliance. The other important concept with regards to iron management is if you have a severe iron deficiency anemia or you don't have a significant amount of time in order to correct the iron deficiency, oral iron can take quite a long time, often months, to correct an iron deficiency anemia, and maybe more, several more months in order to actually replete iron stores. In addition, there are other obstacles to oral iron. If a patient's taking an H2 blocker, proton pump inhibitors, sometimes just certain things in their diet may interfere with iron absorption. And so many patients, even if they can tolerate oral iron, may not absorb much more than just a couple of milligrams of elemental iron. Maybe I think the maximum is considered 5 to 7 milligrams in a day. And as we mentioned earlier, with functional iron deficiency, those patients have a diminished absorption of oral iron or just iron in general from their intestines. So for all of these reasons, over the past probably 10 to 15 years, the use of parenteral iron, especially in the United States, has significantly increased. Where we're seeing a lot of the use, at least originally, was in the population of chronic kidney disease or end-stage renal failure in which iron deficiency was prevalent. 50, 60, 70% or more of these patients have severe iron deficiency and often an associated anemia. However, we're starting to see other patient populations benefit from iron intravenously, and we're starting to see an increase in the utilization of IV iron in patients prior to surgery with iron deficiency anemia. Again, that short time to correct the anemia. Oral iron ineffective, IV iron is more reasonable. We're certainly seeing its use in GI disorders, patients with Crohn's, ulcerative colitis, peptic ulcer, celiac, OBGYN, many women with menorrhagia, menometrorrhagia, pregnancy, and then certainly seeing some use on the hospitalized side of things for patients with acute blood loss. And even though they may have adequate iron stores, often have a functional iron deficiency where IV iron has been shown to accelerate red blood cell production. And lastly, cancer and chemotherapy related anemia, we're seeing an increased utilization, especially with the reduction in the use of erythropoietic agents. IV iron, how does that make you feel? Do you panic a little bit? Do you get nervous? Does that make you think about serious reactions, poor patient outcomes? I think it's interesting because when you talk with nurses, most nurses were trained or taught, many of them years ago, that when we needed to consider the utilization of IV iron, that we panicked a little because we thought about serious, even anaphylactic reactions. It's important as we go over the next few slides to have a better understanding of what is perception versus reality. And so the perception of the risks associated with IV iron have been ongoing for years, in fact, decades. And much of it has been a misperception or a misinterpretation of clinical data and the clinical nature of minor infusion reactions, some of which we'll talk about momentarily. When you think about IV iron, many physicians or hospitals today still utilize pre-medication, which makes you think that the patients are all going to have reactions. And certainly some of the language that we use today by our regulatory agencies also add to some of that concern. It is absolutely true that years ago, early preparations, specifically one or two, were associated with a much higher incidence of adverse events, and some of those very serious adverse events, most notably anaphylactic shock. However, many of the newer formulations and then a lot of the newer published data today supports the fact that IV iron is much safer than historically, and I think much safer than many clinicians give it credit for. They also show that the incidence of serious adverse events are extremely rare. So let's talk about some general nursing principles with IV iron. A well-educated, an experienced nurse is certainly going to be able to allay fears of the staff, certainly will be able to optimize and be able to the management of adverse events and possibly even prevent certain adverse events as well by properly understanding, number one, what are the evidence-based indications or use, administration routes and doses for IV iron, and how to best recognize and manage reactions, whether they be mild, moderate, or even severe. And an experienced nurse or an educated nurse should also be able to understand the fishbane reaction, we'll talk about that in a moment, versus true anaphylaxis, specifically in conjunction with the use of iron dextran INFED. Patient education is also very important, though, and we know this, that sometimes as we educate patients, the way that we do can either increase or decrease levels of anxiety. So as we're preparing to manage a patient, preferably even in advance of them coming in for an infusion, make sure that they've eaten and that they've hydrated properly so that we can get a good stick and not get them started off on the wrong course. Give them the expectation that they may have a mild adverse event, something like a metallic taste in their mouth. They may have some myalgias or arthralgias, and this can help to manage or limit anxiety levels. Explain that severe reactions are rare, however, there's always a very small possibility, but that there's a competent staff, that they'll be monitored very closely, and that the staff is extremely prepared to manage any type of adverse event that may occur. And so as we all understand, a calm, well-educated nurse equals a calm, educated patient, which equals less stress for everyone. Today we have mainly five intravenous iron preparations available for replacement. We'll go through each of these very briefly. Low molecular weight iron dextran, also known as INFED, sodium ferric gluconate, known as ferlisip, iron sucrose, known as venifer, ferrium oxetol, known as ferraheme, and ferric carboxymaltose, also known as injectifer. Some of these have been on the market for decades, and others have recently, just in the past couple or few years, come onto the market as well. So we'll walk through the differences, at least often seen with dosing, administration, although the adverse event panels are pretty similar between them. Let's start with low molecular weight iron dextran, known as INFED. And so the indication for iron dextran here is to treat iron deficiency not amenable to oral iron therapy. And this does allow and has allowed for years the ability to use INFED for a variety of FDA-approved indications not specific to chronic kidney disease, where some of the other irons are limited to. While most of the package insert and some of the recommendations published have limited the dosing to 100 milligrams, again, more appropriate in the sense of a patient on chronic dialysis treatment who could get 100 milligrams at a time, it has been established now for many years and well supported in the literature and clinical practice that a total dose infusion is appropriate under many circumstances. And this does provide some flexibility and true benefit for patients, depending on their needs, who may need a large amount of parenteral iron to either quickly restore hemoglobin levels or to quickly replete an iron depleted patient. Most of the recommendations will either limit this to a gram, 1,000 milligrams, or many others use up to 1,500 milligrams or somewhere in between. And there's typically a calculation that's been well published looking at the patient's need, their current hemoglobin, their desired hemoglobin, weight, etc. One of the limitations with NFED that has been in the package insert for many years, although questioned by certain countries and also many experts in the United States, is the need to provide a test dose. We still do have that in the package insert, and that is still the common practice in the United States to administer a test dose prior to the first therapeutic dose. And then after waiting several minutes to evaluate the presence of a reaction, then the full therapeutic dose can be administered if no signs or symptoms of anaphylactic type reactions are seen. And like with all IV irons, and we'll cover this at the back end, patients should be observed carefully both during and at least for up to 30 minutes after the infusion for signs or symptoms of reactions, including anaphylactic type reactions. There's an additional slide on iron dextran to provide an overview of the safety profile, because many nurses, especially those that have been in the profession for years, may remember that iron dextran was associated or has been associated with life-threatening reactions. However, after further analysis and careful analysis, we now understand that there were really two forms, a high molecular weight iron dextran and a low molecular weight iron dextran, sometimes used interchangeably as just iron dextran. And after really careful analysis, it's been understood that the high molecular weight iron dextran, also known as dexferrin, was behind a significant, if not the majority, percentage of these serious or life-threatening adverse events. So NFED is the only low molecular weight iron dextran. Dexferrin, the high molecular weight iron dextran, has been removed from the market. So this is no longer basically an issue, but it's important to understand historically what had occurred, and again, why even some of those adverse events we may be remembering today and simply lumping them in as related to iron dextran. But it's important to understand the difference. I also want to make a couple of brief comments about something that we've begun to understand better, known as the Fishbane reaction, named after Professor Stephen Fishbane, who in his experience would describe a self-limiting, rare, but self-limiting reaction consisting of acute chest and back tightness without accompanying hypotension, wheezing, stridor, periorbital edema, and it usually occurred after the test dose. Why this is important for nurses to understand is that I think many times over the years when we've seen a reaction early on that may mimic a serious adverse event, like chest pain or tightness, back pain or tightness, that we may be overreacting and in fact, based on the treatment that we administer, may be making the patient worse. So let me share just a little information on the Fishbane reaction. It still doesn't occur infrequently, and it also rarely occurs with a re-challenge. So if you were to allow it to be its self-limiting form, waiting several minutes and then restarting the iron dextran or the NFED, it rarely reoccurs. What's recommended is that the patient be observed without intervention for approximately 5 minutes. If there is cessation of the symptoms, which often occurs, then to again re-challenge the patient. It's important not to overreact, again, to put patients on large amounts of antihistamines or pressors, etc., as this in and of itself can actually cause serious adverse events or, again, hemodynamic instability. The next IV iron on our list is sodium ferric gluconate, also known as ferlisid. And it's been available for quite a few years in the United States, I believe becoming available in 1999 or 2000. The indication for ferlisid has been relatively narrow in its scope, treatment of iron deficiency anemia in patients 6 years or older with chronic kidney disease, receiving chronic hemodialysis and supplemental erythropoietin therapy. However, as we know, with many of the IV irons being used off-label, this has been used outside of that specific indication. The recommended dosage of ferlicit is limited to 125 milligrams. There are some reports or recommendations that a higher dose can be utilized, but some of those have also reported an increase in the risk of reactions with higher doses. So there are some limitations with ferlicit if you are trying to achieve a total dose replacement or a 1 gram repletion of iron, because you would then typically have to give 8 separate individual doses. It may not be a big deal for patients who are hospitalized or those who are receiving chronic dialysis treatment, but this is one of the limitations with ferlicit. There is no test dose required, and most often it's, you know, either administered by IV push over 10 minutes, 12.5 milligrams per minute, or as an IV infusion, typically over an hour, diluted in 100 milliliters of normal saline or similar solution. Iron sucrose, the indication similar to ferlicit is for the treatment of iron deficiency anemia in both adults and in pediatric patients at least 2 years of age with chronic kidney disease. And the dosing and administration with Venofer can vary. Some use 100 milligrams per dose. Others have used 200 milligrams as an injection or infusion. Often commonly used is 300, even up to 400 milligrams per infusion, all based, as you can see on this slide, on the disease state, whether it be peritoneal, non-dialysis, or hemodialysis-dependent chronic kidney disease. Outside of the chronic kidney disease indications, it's not uncommon to see iron sucrose used on the hospital's formulary. And again, it just depends on really what your hospital's guidelines are. However, again, many organizations do utilize 200, 300, even up to 400 milligram dosing recommendations. Now we'll begin to discuss the two newer IV iron preparations available in the United States. The first is ferumoxetol, also known as Ferraheme. And Ferraheme is indicated for the treatment of iron deficiency in adults with chronic kidney disease, so similar to Venofer but without the pediatric indication. The nice thing as we start to discuss Ferraheme and then the second newer intravenous iron preparation is the ability to use larger doses. So the recommended dose of Ferraheme is an initial 510 milligram dose followed by a second dose of 510 milligrams, which gives you that gram. 3 to 8 days later. So typically within 1 week's time, you can completely replace 1 gram of elemental iron, and again, full repletion of the iron stores. No test dose is required, and each dose should typically be infused over at least 15 minutes while the patient is in a reclined or semi-reclined position per the package insert. And lastly, ferric carboxymaltose, also known as Injectafer. This one did receive a different indication, similar to the iron dextran, which allows it broad flexibility in how we utilize it based on the FDA indications. So it's indicated for the treatment of iron deficiency anemia in adult patients who either A, have intolerance to oral iron or have had unsatisfactory response to oral iron, or those who have non-dialysis-dependent chronic kidney disease. So this does allow a large flexibility, FDA-approved utilization in patients such as those with heavy uterine bleeding, postpartum patients, GI disorders, post-gastric bypass, cancer, heart failure, etc. And the nice thing as well with the Injectafer, the ferric carboxymaltose, is the ability to provide a large dose. Each dose is typically 750 milligrams, so it can provide up to 1,500 milligrams of iron in just two administrations, typically separated by at least 7 days. And in fact, one dose in and of itself at 750 milligrams may be enough in certain patients to provide enough IV iron that is needed, and maybe not even requiring a second dose. The administration options for Injectafer, typically intravenously by infusion over at least 15 minutes. However, it can be given as a slow IV push over at least 7.5 minutes. rather than discuss the safety profile after each intravenous iron, since they were so similar based on their package inserts, I lumped it together here at the back end. And a lot of this is direct language from the package insert that you can see. But with each, you know, use of intravenous iron, each patient, we certainly have to be closely monitoring patients for hypersensitivity reactions, which does include the rare but sometimes occurring anaphylactic type reactions. Certainly need to be aware of the more common reactions, which are usually very minor in nature. Urticaria, dyspnea, pruritus, tachycardia. We see a lot of arthralgias or myalgias, which can be easily treated with steroidal or anti-inflammatory type medications. As we're monitoring patients, we should be carefully monitoring them, of course, during, but usually recommended at least 30 minutes after IV iron administration or until clinically stable following completion of the infusion. And then making sure that when we do utilize IV iron, that it's in a setting where we would have the personnel and certainly the therapies available if there was to be a serious reaction. I like to share this slide, which is actually comes directly from the literature published years ago. However, it does show, as we look at serious adverse events for IV iron, it distinguishes between the high molecular weight iron dextran and the low molecular weight iron dextran there in the red and then the orange. And then in the yellow and gray, we see where the ferlecit and the venifer occur. Ultimately, what we note, though, is that there was a significant difference in serious or life-threatening reactions with the high molecular weight iron dextran. And when that is removed, really what we see is that there are very few, and extremely rare, occurrences of serious or life-threatening adverse events. In fact, really, here we see just a couple per 1 million administrations of IV iron. So I hope that this does give some confidence that now that the high molecular weight iron dextran has been removed by the FDA, we're left with iron preparations that are, again, very safe today with very rare incidents of serious adverse events. So as we start to wrap the presentation up and summarize, let's really finish the presentation on some practical matters related to IV iron utilization and management. I think what's important is first to discuss how IV iron products are selected or may be selected by a hospital or a physician. So provider preference may differ among specialists. Nephrologists may want to use, again, some of the products that use lower doses because they know that those patients are our captive audience and they can give as many doses as really needed over the course of their dialysis treatments. Hospital formulary may vary based on some other factors like cost, which may play a role, or again, you might even see some differences on formulary between inpatient and outpatient IV iron availability. Sometimes the reimbursement factor also plays a role, and this may vary by geography or where your hospital is located in the United States. With regards to adverse events rates or adverse event rates, I see this playing a role, even though it probably shouldn't play as big of a role, but previous misconceptions, especially with regards to iron dextran, may factor into how certain physicians or even hospitals determine what's on their formulary and not. But most of the literature, as you've seen, shows similar adverse event rates. And then patient population may also cause us to reevaluate that the appropriate iron product. Again, dialysis, nephrologists may be fine with using some of the lower dose products. Pregnancy, both venifer and ferlecit now have a category B category, whereas the others are category C. So some, again, OBGYN providers may prefer to utilize venifer or ferlecit in the pregnant population. With regards to dosing, that also should play a significant role in how we determine the appropriate IV iron. It may depend on clinical circumstances, but a lot of hospitals or providers may not utilize the products like Ferlicit or Venofer with lower total doses per infusion when they're trying to achieve total dose infusion or iron replacement. This is where sometimes the Infed or the Injectafer, which can be given up to a total of 1,500 milligrams, again, Infed one dose, the Injectafer two doses, or Ferraheen, which you can give up to 1,020 milligrams over two doses, that might be desirable in certain circumstances, one in which you know that you need to replace over or 1 gram or more of iron based on your assessment of the patient. Or it might also be practical to utilize this when there's limited time between the point of identifying iron deficiency anemia and the time which you need to correct it. This could certainly be in the situation where a patient has ongoing blood loss or a patient who's pre-surgical, where we only have a week or two or three prior to surgery where we want to correct the anemia. Or in a patient that you're trying to avoid a transfusion, or maybe a patient refusing blood where we need rapid correction of iron stores to, again, replete and then help us to regenerate hemoglobin and red cell mass. Patient geography may play a role, mobility issues, transportation challenges as well. So if you only get one shot, or preferably one shot to make it easier for that patient not to have to make multiple trips, you may want to select one of the products where you can give a total dose infusion or a large amount of IV iron in one sitting. And otherwise, it should really depend on patient convenience and chair time. Just a couple of other practical matters when treating a patient with IV iron is what should be the expectation? How much of an effect and how quickly of an effect would we expect? So a patient with iron deficiency who has adequate marrow reserve and a relatively normal erythropoietic response, it's not unreasonable to see a half of a gram to 1 gram of hemoglobin increase, or gram per deciliter in hemoglobin increase every week. In some cases, you might even see more depending on the patient. When you do have a patient with true iron deficiency, if it hasn't been worked up or understood as to the etiology, it's important to make sure that the physician or the primary care provider is performing a proper workup, as it could be indicative of a more serious medical condition. And then there's a number of recommendations in the literature. Many clinicians would add some folate, maybe 1 gram orally per day, or 500 milligrams of vitamin C twice daily, which has also been shown to increase absorption in some ways, but also might favor some pathways that keep iron as ferritin rather than hemosiderin. So in summary, let's talk about some of the safety parameters of IV iron. Well, I know that many hospitals in the United States might still be utilizing pre-medication, especially if they're using an iron dextran. For the most part, this has been discouraged in the literature and certainly not necessary for the IV irons that we've reviewed. Unless there is some sort of a history of a reaction, or if the patient has a very common allergy to multiple medications, it might be a reasonable consideration. The most common reactions that we would see today would be flushing, pruritus, urticaria, rash, in some cases hypotension, self-limiting usually, but it is important to know that hypotension has often been associated with a more rapid infusion. So my opinion is that whenever possible, if the time is allowed to utilize the infusion when available, and again, a slower infusion time has been associated with a lower risk of hypotension. In general, the overall serious adverse event rate is reported at 3.8 per million doses, so again, extremely rare. And many of those life-threatening adverse events that we noted historically and that have really weighed into the perception of the harm of IV iron was associated with the high molecular weight iron dextran, which is no longer available. And lastly, I would say with the safety, you know, although serious adverse events are rare, it is important to monitor the patients and at least monitor them during and up to 30 minutes after the infusion is complete. So I'll leave you with some concluding thoughts. Like all treatments, like all medications, IV iron has benefits and it has risks. It's important to understand those benefits and risks as any type of clinician, especially a nurse. And if you want more information, certainly on the Iron Corner through the Society for the Advancement of Blood Management, you can gather much more information on this topic. With regards to the benefits, I think it's important to recognize that by preventing or managing anemia, we can restore quality of life to patients who may have been extremely fatigued or be at risk for serious adverse consequences of anemia. I know over the years, we've treated patients who have been trying on oral iron alone to correct their anemia and either couldn't work anymore, they couldn't be the parent, the wife, that they wanted to be, or the husband, and by, you know, again, properly correcting the anemia in a rapid fashion, we were able to really restore a life for many patients that they hadn't known in years. The other piece that I think we haven't talked about much today, but close, near and dear to many of us, is that through the, again, proper management or prevention of anemia, we're able to prevent or reduce exposure to allogeneic transfusion, which over the past few years we've begun to clearly understand that we've underestimated many of the risks associated with. So both of these are extremely important benefits to consider as we're looking to utilize, correct anemia or to utilize something like intravenous iron. There are risks. Patients have reactions, many of them very minor, allergic reactions, again, periodically some hypotension. Rarely we might have some dyspnea, chest pain, or again, extremely rare anaphylactic reactions. But it's important to know and to distinguish in patients, again, benefits, risks, and really take into consideration their circumstances. Nurses must be aware of these benefits and risks, and they must be, again, very knowledgeable about the administration, as well as the importance of monitoring patients both during and after IV iron administration. I want to thank you for your attention and participation in this program. I hope that this was able to provide a nice overview of how to identify and manage intravenous iron, the different types of IV irons available, and certainly the benefits and risks of parenteral iron administration. If you'd like more information, definitely go to the Iron Corner, where you can find much more on IV iron, iron deficiency anemia, laboratory assessment of iron deficiency, etc. And I'm leaving you here with some references as well that certainly I encourage you to investigate further. So thank you.